it's Anna, and today I want to talk about the making of this sweater. So this sweater is part of my Historybounding capsule wardrobe, which, if you don't know about that ongoing project, I will link the video down below, or in a card, somewhere it will be linked. But the main premise was to design a number of garments that would all work together, and this garment was actually the jumping off point. At the time I made that video, I already had the back knitted for this sweater, so I sort of used it to set a color palette, a little bit of a tone, that sort of thing, for the rest of the items. But for now, let's talk about this sweater. So this sweater was knit following an authentic 1930s sweater pattern, which came with a few difficulties. The first of which was right at the beginning with finding a yarn to knit this out of. The original pattern recommended using Fleischmann's yarn, and that is a company that is no longer in business. And unfortunately, they also didn't recommend a weight of yarn, just this particular yarn made by this particular brand. So problem number one was finding another yarn that would be appropriate. Luckily, I was able to find a fine sport weight yarn sold by a company on Etsy. I will link them down below because their yarn is beautiful. This was a wonderful yarn to work with. It is 100% alpaca, which means it is very, very soft, which, although it was difficult to work with in some cases because of that, means that this finished sweater is very lovely and soft and comfortable. So, highly recommend them. They're great. Links, links, links down below. So that was problem number one. And then the next sort of problem I encountered with the directions for this sweater was actually with the cabling. So now when we knit a cabled pattern, we use a cabling needle, which is a needle that's sort of shaped like a J almost. And this makes it very easy. You slip on your stitches, you knit them off. Wonderful. The directions for this pattern recommended using a crochet hook of a particular size, which did work. I tried it and it did work, but it was very, very annoying. The stitches slipped off. It was hard to keep control of. I had to sort of always be holding that essentially extra needle, even though it's a hook, as well. So I do not recommend following that instruction if you choose to knit this pattern. I will link this pattern down below, but be warned, that is not the only difficulty of the instructions. And for that particular difficulty, just use a cabling needle right off the bat. I wanted to try it just to make this garment as authentically as I could, but yeah, it was not worth it. Just use a cabling needle. Now, other problems with this pattern. I think it's a beautiful pattern. I think all the pieces are lovely. It comes in a set of three. It also includes a cape and a skirt. I have not made either of those, but in general, this pattern was extremely difficult to follow. The instructions were somewhat vague. They didn't include any diagrams other than just teaching you how to cast on, which is weird that they teach you that, but then not show diagrams of their very specific instructions. So it was kind of hard to follow, and at points I did kind of have to make things up. Most notably, I made sort of an executive decision to change how I did the pattern of the actual sweater. So what I mean by that is that in my sweater, the cabling stops kind of here. In the pattern, they instruct you to continue the cabling throughout, but they also want you to decrease in such a way that that interferes with the cable knit pattern. So I'm not sure what they want you to do, and I decided, you know what, I'm just going to do a rib pattern and have it be sort of pattern blocked. So I had to make that change. Another change, as you'll see later, is that the sleeve heads are gigantic on this. Like, they're so long. And they, again, do not give clear instruction about how to set them in. So you'll see my solution to that later on, but I basically made them into pseudo shoulder pads. That's kind of my major complaint about this pattern, is that it's just not clear, and I wish it were clearer, and some of the instructions seem to contradict others, and I ended up making a lot of this up, so definitely a process. I unfortunately did not film all of it. I filmed the making of the sleeves, I filmed kind of the putting together of the pieces, but I just didn't think to film knitting the rest of it for some reason. I think I was sort of going back and forth on whether to make a video on this piece, and ultimately decided to do it and really wish I'd filmed, but oh well, hindsight's 20/20, right? So I'll take you along with me for as much as I can, and if you want to see the rest of how this was made, continue watching this video.
So at this point, I've knit basically to where I need to do the decrease. I have the cuff done, that was in a single rib, and then I have the body of the sleeve done, which is in a double rib or a 2x2 rib. And I added a little bit of extra length in the body of the sleeve because I wanted the sleeves to go down to my elbows rather than just sort of mid-bicep level. So I added that length there. And now it's time to make the sleeve head by doing some decreases. So let me grab my first sleeve that I made to show you. Here's the first sleeve, and where it starts to decrease is basically where we are now. So now I need to do these decreases, and then it'll be ready to attach. I think it folds kind of like this, and that's how it forms a sleeve. And then the curved bit will be the arm side, but we'll see once I actually have everything so I can start attaching pieces. I also have these little threads, so I'm going to go ahead and tuck all those in, finish up the decreases, and yeah, I'll get back once it's time to start attaching things. Okay, so I have finished knitting the second sleeve. It took me way longer than I anticipated. Yeah, it just took me a bit. Don't really know why. I don't know why the first one went faster, but it is what it is. I have not tucked in all the like little ends and stuff yet, but I just wanted to show you guys this. I messed up while knitting. I missed a stitch and it unraveled a bit, and that caused some problems. And I just wanted to share that because I think it's important to share that, you know, projects don't turn out perfectly, and that's okay. I think I'll be able to mostly fix it. So let me show you. Come on, camera. You really want to focus. Maybe. I don't know how well you can see, but there's sort of a little distortion in the pattern here. My sort of plan is to weave this back in, so sew the one loose stitch that I've kept on this. I've always called them stitch minders, but there might be other names. I've kept it on the stitch minder or marker, and there's this kind of hole here. So I'm just going to go ahead and close that. So that closed along with tucking in the rest of the ends and everything else. So yeah, I will check back in once that's all done. Thank you. started with a few different methods for stitching together the seams. Some sources recommended using a ladder stitch, some recommended a blanket stitch. I ended up doing this sort of quasi ladder whip stitch thing. I'm not quite sure how to describe it, but you should be able to see kind of what I'm doing here. And that's how I started off doing the seams, but I eventually just transitioned to using a regular backstitch and doing my seams how I always do when I hand sew, and that ended up being way easier and better. So yeah, the majority are done with the backstitch, but the first few are done with this weird whatever it is stitch. Of a seam. This goes for weird stitched and back stitched seams. I just tied a knot and left myself a tail to tuck in like any other tail on a knitting project. Once all the construction seams for each piece were done, I aligned the side seam of the sweater with the sleeve seam and just used a whole bunch of pins to pin it into the arm's eye. This is what I always do. I always just use a ton of pins and hand backstitch it in place, smoothing it as I go, and this seems to work pretty well. I neglected to film what I did with the extra tall sleeve head bit. I think just because it ended up being very weird, but because the sleeve head was so long, I ended up just tucking it underneath the shoulder seam as sort of a pseudo shoulder pad thing. Yeah, it was weird, but it worked. And that's kind of the motto for this sweater. It was weird, but it worked. And then all I had left to do was the collar, which, again, I neglected to get any footage of that, but it was just sort of crocheted. I completely made it up. So yeah, I'll let outro Anna explain kind of how that went.
Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope I was able to explain how I did this sweater as clearly as possible, even if the directions weren't super clear in the actual pattern. A couple of things to wrap up my thoughts about this project are things I'd change. So if I were to make this again, the number one thing I'd change, I guess there are two things that I would change that are sort of tied for first place. But the one I'm going to talk about first are the sleeves. So these sleeves, as you can see, they are gigantic on me. They are much too wide. This is not really the pattern's fault. I just have noodle arms, and the pattern is only fit by a measurement of the bust, so that's not really its fault. It only gives one measurement. What are you gonna do? But if I were to make this pattern again, or my altered version of this pattern again, I would definitely decrease the number of stitches I cast on for the sleeves, just to take in that extra bit. Because this sweater is meant to have not tight sleeves, but fitted sleeves, and it definitely does not. So that's one thing I change. The other thing I change is the construction of the collar. So I was kind of on my own for the collar. It gave instructions about crocheting that didn't make sense. So I ended up just making up something, and it works, but I don't like how it sort of folds up like this, and it also still has kind of these V shapes at the points of the shoulders. That's because it ends up being sort of a boat neck when you're done knitting, and you want it to be a mock neck. So that transition I didn't do as well as I'd like to, but I need to keep those corners in place because that is how I fit my head through, and that makes this a functional garment. But that is definitely something I'd look into doing differently next time. And what I might do is just make, if I were to make this again, make the collar sort of split or make the back panel split at a certain point, because that would give me an opening and I could just have a fastening, and that would be much better, I think. So those are kind of the main things. The other things I think are just features of this type of garment that are new to me and a different look to me, but aren't necessarily bad. So my sort of shoulder pad adaptation is definitely not what is written in the pattern, but it is very in keeping with the late 1930s, early 1940s era. Strong shoulders were in. I will put some sort of example pictures to show what I mean, but you very much wanted these like powerful shoulders tapering down to a slim waist. That was the look. And so I think that although this is something I just sort of came up with to deal with the sleeve heads, it's very in keeping with that look. And I'm not entirely sure if I like it. I think I do. I've worn the sweater a couple of times just to test out how I feel about it, and I think I do like it. It's just a very different silhouette than I'm used to seeing. So I think that's something I'll get used to with time, and isn't really a strict change I'd make, but would be something to consider doing differently for next time, just to have a less strong shoulder option. And yeah, overall, I'm very pleased with how this project turned out. Gripes aside, I think it's a lovely sweater. I think I'll get a lot of use out of it, and I especially like that it's somewhat cropped, because when I wear skirts, that's one complaint I have about sweaters I own, is that they just fall too low for the type of flared skirt I like, and it isn't the most flattering. And I think this does a better job of being paired with skirts. So that's definitely something I like, and I think I'll definitely get a lot of wear out of it. And I am now rambling, so I think I'm gonna end things here. Thanks again for watching. If you liked it, give it a like. If you wanna see more like this, go ahead and subscribe. And I hope to catch you later. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you next time. Bye.